The heart is a piece of inspiration. There's a band named Heart. Edgar Allan Poe wrote about the telltale heart. Elton John and Kiki Dee wrote a classic song titled Don't Go Breaking My Heart. Many a singer has talked about hearts and mi corazón. I mean, I could go on and on. We can love someone with all a heart, and the symbol for love is a heart. Blood itself has other meanings, and vampires come to mind about sucking people's blood. The cardiovascular system is inspirational, and we know someone gives their best effort when they give their blood, sweat, and tears. Well, welcome to our second deep dive into the physiology of humans. This one's a biggie, and it is complex and full of details. This is 6.2, the blood system. In this topic, you will learn many things about how blood is transported, how our blood vessels are structured and function, and all about the ticking thing in our chest that we call the heart. There are many health issues that are related to this topic, and of course, real-life implications. If you're ever interested in studying medicine, nursing, or just wanting to understand more about heart issues, this is the place to start. It's a really fascinating topic, in my opinion, and if your heart is set on it, you might just fall in love. Ha! So let's get to it and start off with the basics. The essential idea here is that blood system continuously transports substances to cells and simultaneously collects waste products. Everybody knows something about the blood system and the heart, even if it's basic knowledge, like simply knowing that we have a heart and that it transports blood around our body. That's a great place to start. So let's add to it. As you can see here, the technical definition for blood is a body fluid that delivers necessary substances, such as nutrients and oxygen, to the cells and transports metabolic waste products away from those same cells. Humans, on average, have between 5 to 6 liters of blood. Of course, this number varies based on the size of the human, but it gives you a good idea. You can see all of the major blood transport systems in the image to the right. The blood highway, which kind of sounds like a horror movie, or a vampire's favorite place to be, is made up of arteries, which are the red things, and veins, which are the blue things. Not pictured there are the capillaries, which we'll talk about in a minute. I'm sure that you've bled before, and you know that blood tends to have a red color. It looks just like one substance, but actually, blood has many different components. So what are these components? Well, there are 4 major components of blood. The biggest component is plasma, which, as you can see here, is mainly water. There are some important electrolytes in there, like sodium and potassium. There are also proteins to help in the clotting process, to stop the bleeding. Because it is the largest part of blood, and mainly water, this enables a swift and efficient transport. Another major component are red blood cells, which are also called erythrocytes. These are the parts of the blood that give the red color, and are responsible for transporting oxygen, which binds to a substance called hemoglobin in these cells. Red blood cells are specially designed to carry this oxygen, and don't have DNA, or a nucleus. The other 2 components that you need to know are white blood cells, also called leukocytes, and platelets, which are called thrombocytes. These only make up roughly 1% of the blood, but they are important. White blood cells are the defenders of the body from invaders, and platelets help to stop bleeding when it occurs and act as a repair kit for the blood system. This should probably go without saying, but the system is really, really important and keeps us alive. As we talked about during digestion, the cells of our body need substances to live, and the majority of these substances are gained through the processes of absorption in the villi into our capillaries. With the addition of oxygen from the process of breathing, we have all the good things to take to their destination cell. When these goods are dropped off, the waste products are picked up and transported to their proper disposal points. All of this movement is kept going by our pumping heart. The heart moves blood around and on average beats between 60 to 80 times per minute. The transport system. The highways consist of arteries, capillaries, and veins. The structures of these 3 make the system work well enough to keep us living. You can see this network in the image in the bottom left. Oh yeah, you need to know what the composition of plasma is. And you can remember it with the mnemonic of NACHO, which consists of nutrients, antibodies, carbon dioxide, hormones, oxygen, urea, and heat. For oxygen and carbon dioxide, these are mainly transported by red blood cells, but can be found in plasma also. So let's talk about the background of these transport structures, the arteries, capillaries, and veins. First up, we have arteries, which carry high-pressure blood away from the heart to the systems that need it. Remember, arteries away. The major arteries branch into smaller arteries called arterioles. Same function, just smaller. The arterioles branch out further near their destination tissues into capillaries, which are at a low pressure and are very small. There are many, many branches of capillaries in our bodies, and this is the place that exchange of all the good things happen and the waste products are leaving. The blood continues moving back towards the heart and into small vessels called venules, which are small veins. The veins, which are at a low pressure, are where blood moves towards the heart, and they're specially adapted to ensure blood moves in the correct direction. These are the basics of this, and it's important to understand this. We're going to dive in deeper and talk more about arteries, capillaries, and veins, their specific structures, and how these structures help them to function. You should be able to compare and contrast these three vessel types. First up, we have the arteries. As I mentioned, arteries transport blood away from the heart. They're thick and muscular and have a small lumen, which if you remember from digestion, is the empty space in the middle. This ensures that blood is kept at a high pressure of 80 to 120 millimeters of mercury, which you see as the symbol of mmHg, millimeters of mercury. These are the units that blood pressure is measured in. So the function of arteries is to maintain blood at a high pressure of 80 to 120 millimeters of mercury and to transport oxygen-rich blood to the places it is needed. As you can see from the structure, there is a thick muscular wall and a fibrous outer layer. The role of the muscular wall is to contract to decrease the size of the lumen. As you know, when you squeeze a liquid, it will travel to areas of lower pressure. So this moves blood along and keeps it at a higher pressure. The elastic fibers ensure that the arteries are stretchy and can increase in size, but that they recoil back to their initial position. This ensures that blood is kept at a high pressure. The walls are thick because the blood is at a high pressure. At this point, you probably realize that maintaining a high pressure between 80 to 120 millimeters of mercury is important. When the heart beats, the elastic fibers stretch with what is called a vasodilation, which is a fancy way of saying that they expand. Then they recoil into their initial position. The muscles in the lining of the arteries constrict in a process known as vasoconstriction between the heartbeats. The prefix of vaso or vaso simply refers to the size of the blood vessels. The last thing to mention here is something you might have heard before in a health class. When the heart beats, there is a high pressure. This is called the systolic pressure. When the heart's at rest, this is called a diastolic pressure. If you've heard of someone having too high of a blood pressure, this means the blood is flowing through smaller opening than normal. And this can lead to a weakening of the arterial muscle and elastic fibers. Moving right along, the blood flows from the arteries into the arterioles, and then we reach the capillaries. The function of the capillaries is to exchange materials between the cells and tissues and blood traveling at low pressure. Capillaries are the smallest of the blood vessels, and the structures are adapted for this function of exchange. First, the pressure is very low, like less than 10 millimeters of mercury. Also, there are many, many branches, which slows down the speed that blood travels. This enables tissues to get the things they need while simultaneously getting rid of waste products. Capillaries themselves are specialized. They have a very small diameter, which allows passage of only a single red blood cell at a time. The capillary wall is made of single layer of cells. They are surrounded by a basement membrane, which is permeable to necessary materials, and they may contain pores to further aid in the transport of materials between tissue fluid and blood. As you can see, capillary structure may vary depending on its location in the body and specific role. In the examples here, the continuous types might be found in muscle tissues and would limit the passage of large molecules. The fenestrated type might be found in the intestines or kidneys and help with absorption. In the sinusoidal type, this might be found in the liver and be permeable to these large molecules. In the image at the bottom, you can see that the change in pressure from the beginning to the end of the capillary ensures that substances are exchanged. At the beginning, the capillary is at a higher pressure than the tissue, so it moves plasma and oxygen into the tissue. At the end of the capillary, the pressure is lower in the capillary than on the tissue, and the tissue will move waste products and carbon dioxide into the capillary. Pretty rad, don't you say? Blood then leaves the capillaries and moves into the venules and the veins. The function of veins is to collect the blood from the tissues and move it at a low pressure to the heart. Blood in the veins is at a low pressure of only 5 to 10 millimeters of mercury. This is quite low, and the structures are adapted to ensure that it's kept low, but that blood continues moving toward the heart. In comparison to arteries, the lumen is much larger. Because of the low pressure, the walls are less elastic, contain less muscle, and are much thinner. You can see this in the image. Additionally, veins contain valves, which get pushed open when the heart beats, moving blood through the valve. When the heart is at rest, these valves close, which prevent backflow of the blood. Lastly, the low pressure of blood in the veins means they need some help to move right along. Remember that there's not much muscle tissue in veins, so many veins pass near to muscles, and the contraction of these muscles squeeze blood through the valves and continue it moving towards the heart. Many veins also run parallel to arteries, so the pulsing of arteries can also be used to influence the movement of blood. And you can see this in the image in the bottom right. So now that we've discussed arteries, capillaries, and veins, let's look at a nice comparison chart. You should be able to discuss the similarities and differences. Lots of information here, so pause it and have a look. We will be using this to help us practice and understand as we work to make these comparison statements. One skill that you need to know is how to identify the different types of blood vessels in the micrograph image. You can see here that arteries, capillaries, and veins all look different. You can see that each type shows different structures. So pause the video here and test yourselves on the images below at the bottom. Each image has an artery and a vein. Hopefully that identification went well for you, and you can see that arteries are more narrow, have thicker walls, and are generally more circular than veins. You can see that veins have wider lumens, thinner walls, and are not as circular. We're going to be practicing this in class as well. Capillaries are somewhat similar to arteries, but not as thick. Now that we've learned about the transport vessels of the blood system, let's step back for a moment and ask ourselves how humans first learned all this. Tying this to the nature of science and history, we need to highlight two people, Galen, a Greek philosopher, and William Harvey, who is an English physician. Galen hailed from Greece in the 2nd and 3rd centuries. Like many philosophers, Galen was curious and did much exploration to the realm of science. Galen did not have many tools at his disposal to really go at the microscopic level, but through his explorations into how the body worked, he made some conclusions about the blood system. Namely, there were three conclusions he reached. First, that arteries and veins were separate blood networks, except where they were connected via these invisible pores. Second, veins were thought to pump natural blood, which was believed to be produced by the liver. Lastly, Galen concluded that arteries were thought to pump heat, which was produced by the heart via the lungs for cooling, like bellows. It all sounds silly, but Galen's ideas were still around 1500 years later when William Harvey came along. Harvey hailed from England and was a physician. He was skilled at anatomy and physiology and studying the human body. Most physicians at the time believed that the lungs were responsible for moving blood around. Harvey, observing the notion of the heart in living animals, was able to see that systole was the active phase of the heart's movement, pumping out the blood by its muscular contraction. Having perceived that the quantity of blood issuing from the heart at any given time was too much to be absorbed by the tissues, he was able to show that the valves in the veins permit the blood to flow only in the direction of the heart, and to prove that the blood circulated around the body and returned to the heart. You can see that Harvey made three key findings. First, that arteries and veins were a single connected network, and that the heart pumped the blood in the arteries away from the heart, and the veins, with their valves, return blood towards the heart. He did not, however, predict or understand capillaries at the time. In summary, Harvey was able to reject Galen's theory through research and experimentation, and create his own theory based on his research. As we know, this is how science works, and theories have much evidence, but are not 100% certain. Theories can be modified or even rejected if more evidence is able to be collected, or improvements in technology provide more accurate evidence. In addition to Harvey's initial theory, we've learned much about the heart and circulatory system. The human heart has four chambers, with two atria and two ventricles. The reason for two sets of atria and ventricles is due to the two distinct circulation pathways. The human body has double circulation. What this means is that one pathway takes deoxygenated blood from the heart to the lungs for exchanging oxygen and carbon dioxide, and then brings back oxygen-rich blood to the heart. This is the right side of the heart, and is the pulmonary circulation. The left side of the heart pumps oxygenated blood around the body, which is called systemic circulation. Compared to other chordates, like fish, reptiles, and amphibians, mammalian hearts are unique in being four-chambered. Fish hearts have two chambers, and reptile and amphibian hearts have three chambers. This also means that the four-chambered heart has two distinct pumps, or a double pump, and the left side of the heart has a thicker muscle and is a bit larger, as it must pump blood to the far reaches of the body. You definitely need to know this, as well as know how to draw a diagram to illustrate the double circulation system in mammals. We've talked about the blood vessels, and we've talked about the history and scientific theory about the blood system, but we have yet to talk about the main star of the show, the heart. So give it up for the heart! Alright, most of the rest of this lecture is going to be discussing the following: the anatomy of the heart, how it pumps and functions, how the nervous system and hormones influence the heart, and how the heartbeat is regulated. There's a lot of detail that's coming your way. So much detail. The only way for you to learn all this is to read, practice using the terms, and practice more. The good news is that, like many topics in human physiology, there's a logical order for everything. And if you know the terms, structures, and functions, you can logically put together the story. But you have to study it and apply it. So, this is the heart. You can see that here. You must be able to draw and annotate a diagram of the heart with the following structure names: superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, pulmonary semilunar valve, aorta, pulmonary artery, pulmonary veins, aortic semilunar valve, left atrioventricular valve, left ventricle, septum, right ventricle, left atrium, right atrium, and right atrioventricular valve. We're going to be practicing this because that's the only way to learn it. So here are two diagrams of the heart. The diagram on the left are all the parts of the heart from the last slide that I mentioned, except the septum. These are the components of the heart where blood is passing through. In the bottom right image, this is the electrical impulse system of the heart with all of the important pieces that are labeled. So I'm going to be focusing on each image separately and discuss the various parts. In the slides that follow, you can see some writing that you can use as guidance. So let me talk about how blood moves through the heart. I will start with the superior and inferior vena cavas, which are the veins that enter into the heart. Specifically, deoxygenated blood enters the heart through the vena cava and into the right atrium. Deoxygenated blood moves through one of the atrioventricular valves, so the right atrioventricular valve, which is called the tricuspid valve, and into the right ventricle. This deoxygenated blood then moves through one of the semilunar valves, which is called the pulmonary valve, into the pulmonary artery. Deoxygenated blood then goes into the lungs, where it's loaded up with oxygen and exchanges carbon dioxide to be breathed out. The oxygen-rich blood then travels back towards the heart via the pulmonary veins, where it enters the left atrium. The oxygenated blood moves through the other atrioventricular valve, which is called the bicuspid valve, and into the left ventricle. The blood then moves through the other semilunar valve, which is called the aortic valve, and into the aorta, where the oxygen-rich blood is distributed to the arteries, then arterioles, and then capillaries. Once the oxygen-rich blood reaches the capillaries, the oxygen and carbon dioxide are exchanged, nutrients are given, waste products loaded, and the deoxygenated blood then travels to the venules, then to the veins, once again into the vena cava, and into the right atrium of the heart. That's how it works, folks. That's the cycle of blood flow, with the major parts outlined. The second image is of the pacemakers of the heart and the electrical impulses. I'll talk more in depth in the next few slides or in a few slides about how the heartbeat is controlled by these impulses, as well as the brain and how it's influenced. This slide is a general explanation of the parts of the heart. Pause it here if you wish. So this is the whole shebang and includes all of the components where blood is passing through, as well as the parts of the heart that control the beating and rhythm. Specifically, these parts of the heart are the centroatrial node, the atrioventricular node, the AV bundle, the bundles of His, the Purkinje fibers, and the septum. Pause it here to have a look and take note that any diagram you draw should show the left side larger than the right side, and the left cardiac muscle being thicker. It's optional to show the different entrances of the vena cava and pulmonary vein, as well as the different branches of the aorta and the pulmonary artery. So how does the heart know when to beat and how to adjust the beat? These are important questions. My best advice for you is to find a picture of the heart from three slides ago with all the parts that control the rhythm. That way you can understand as I explain this. The first thing to know about the heart is that it's myogenic, which means that the signal for the heartbeat is actually initiated by cells within the heart and not the brain. The brain helps to organize and send some signals, that is for sure though. The heartbeat is initiated within the walls of the right atrium with a group of specialized cells called the sinoatrial node, or SA node, or the SAN. The sinoatrial node acts as the primary pacemaker and controls the rate at which the heart beats. It is the controller of the rhythm of the beat of the heart. Typically, a normal rhythm is between 60 and 100 beats per minute. Electrical signals arising in the SA node, which are located in the right atrium, stimulate the atria to contract. Then the signals travel to the atrioventricular node, or the AV node, which is located in the interatrial septum. After a delay, the electrical signal diverges and is conducted through the left and right bundles of His to the respective Purkinje fibers for each side of the heart, as well as to the endocardium, then finally to the ventricular epicardium, causing its contraction. These signals are generated rhythmically, which in turn results in the coordinated rhythmic contraction and relaxation of the heart. If the SA node fails, the AV node can take over the myogenic beating. In the worst case scenario, the bundles of His can take over. These are the secondary and tertiary pacemakers, but they're not as efficient as the primary pacemaker. You can see in the top right image how the pacemaking influences the muscles of the different parts of the heart to contract. You can also see the delays between the different electrical impulses. As I mentioned before, the heart is myogenic, but it can be influenced by the nervous system as well as the endocrine system. This is important because if your heart beat at the same rhythm, no matter what you were doing, you would not get enough oxygen in times of exercise or in situations where you needed to increase or decrease your heart rate, like if you were running away from a dinosaur. In the brain, the medulla is the portion that's responsible for regulating the heart rate. The sympathetic nerve releases a neurotransmitter called noradrenaline to increase the rate of the heart. On the flip side, the parasympathetic nerve releases the neurotransmitter acetylcholine to decrease the heart rate. Stress, caffeine, and excitement may temporarily accelerate your heart rate, while meditating or taking slow, deep breaths may help to slow your heart rate. Exercising for any duration will increase your heart rate and will remain elevated for as long as the exercise is continued. At the beginning of exercise, your body removes a parasympathetic stimulation, which enables the heart rate to gradually increase. As you exercise more strenuously, the sympathetic system kicks in to accelerate your heart rate even more. Additionally, your brain tells your body's adrenal glands to secrete adrenaline, which is the longer-term way your body maintains an elevated heart rate. Nervous system impulses and neurotransmitters are short-term, but hormones are long-term. Putting all the pieces together of this puzzle is really important. The whole puzzle about how the heart works and beats is knowing the cardiac cycle. You must be able to discuss the cardiac cycle and understand how it works. Specifically, the cardiac cycle is a series of events that takes place over the duration of a single heartbeat and is comprised of a contraction called a systole and a relaxation called a diastole. There are two systoles, the atrial systole and the ventricular systole. I will start with the atrial systole. When the atrium contracts, the ventricles are relaxed. The pressure in the atrium is high at this point. Blood is forced into the ventricles through the atrioventricular valves. However, the semilunar valves are closed. When the ventricles are pretty much filled with blood, the ventricular systole occurs. The atrium relaxes, the atrioventricular valves close, and the ventricle contracts. Pressure in the ventricles and arteries is high. This pushes blood back through the semilunar valves and into the arteries. Once the ventricular systole finishes, both the atrium and ventricles are relaxed. This is the diastole. During this time, the semilunar valves are closed, maintaining pressure in the arteries, and the atrioventricular valves are open. Blood is free to flow into the atrium and the ventricles at this point. The pressure in the atrium and ventricles is low. You should be able to compare the two systoles and diastole as it's indicated in the chart here. Additionally, you need to be able to explain the atrioventricular and arterial pressure changes as illustrated on a graph of pressure changes during the cardiac cycle. So, here we have a graph for you to indicate this. You can notice that the pressure in the aorta, which is the main artery out of the left ventricle, is always 90 millimeters of mercury and above. During the atrial systole, the left atrium does not get above 20 millimeters of mercury. However, the ventricular systole pushes both the left ventricle pressure and pressure in the aorta up to 120 millimeters of mercury. During the diastole, the aortic pressure is about 90 millimeters of mercury, and the ventricle and atrial pressures are very low. All of this happens within a time frame of 650 milliseconds. You can also see which part of the cycle produces the lub and dub sounds. The lub is caused by the AV valves closing, and the dub is caused by the closing of the semilunar valves at the end of the ventricular systole. Here is a really awesome animation that outlines this whole process in real time, putting the cardiac cycle into action, complete with the graphs. I encourage you to go to the tutorial linked here and slow it down. I can't stop watching it. It's like a symphony of awesomeness. Cardiologists can look at an echocardiogram and gauge potential issues with the heart, and that's called an ECG. So we have hit the home stretch. Last slide. This is a lot of information. But one application we have not yet discussed are health issues related to the blood system. You probably know of a few, like high blood pressure, heart attacks, strokes, etc. So let's talk about one specific instance, which are the coronary arteries. As you know, blood flows through the heart, and the heart is a muscle. Well, the heart muscle has arteries that provide oxygen and nutrients to it just like other tissues. These are called the coronary arteries. Sometimes, these arteries can become narrowed and occluded, which for the heart muscle can cause devastating consequences. One cause of coronary occlusion is atherosclerosis, which is the hardening and narrowing of the arteries due to deposition of cholesterol. Over a period of time, the atherosclerosis can cause damage to the coronary arteries, leading to blood clots, and even further narrowing of the coronary arteries. You can see this in the image at the bottom right. Eventually, if coronary arteries are completely blocked, cardiac muscle tissues will be cut off from vital oxygen and nutrients and will cease to function. This will result in an abnormal contraction of the heart, which is a heart attack. However, modern medicine has enabled treatment options to be pursued, like a bypass surgery or a stent that is created and placed in a coronary artery to keep it from being occluded. However, a heart attack can cause damage to the heart or weaken it. Coronary heart disease has been researched extensively, and there are many risk factors for the disease. You can see them here in the upper right. The mnemonic A Goddess is a way to remember. They include age, genetics, obesity, diseases, diet, exercise, sex, like gender, and smoking. You should know the causes and consequences of occlusion. For everything that we covered in this lecture, there are many more things that were not covered. So be curious. Look up information about conditions and situations related to the heart. The more you know about this part of the human physiology, the more you understand about life. So keep on keeping on, and may your hearts be healthy and beat strong. As always, it's really important to give credit where it's due. While the presentation, script, and video are solely of my own creation, many of the images and information contained in the presentation are not. So shout outs to the following. Most of the images and video clips come from IV Bio Ninja and some of the information that was used. Other images and info came from Bionology, iBiology, and Biology for Life. Lastly, some information was gleaned from the Cambridge edition of the IB Biology text, as the intended purpose of this presentation is to provide you with yet another resource tool to enhance your learning for the IB Biology curriculum. So peace out.